Good morning. We're going to start favorite hymns this morning, and we'll let you choose, but first we're going to sing one verse of America and one verse of America the Beautiful. $6.96 and $6.97. Which one first?
$6.96.
Thank you. may be seated. I'm Dennis Carter. I'm pastor. Let me see if I get this all right. I'm pastor here at Ellsworth First United Methodist Church. I'm also pastor at Kannapolis and also at Wilson. That was the first day at Wilson, but you guys have a totally different message. But it's a blessing to have you here. I pray that each and every one feels God's presence and know that you are loved. You always have been and you always will be. And what a blessing it is here on the 4th of July as we reflect on the freedom that we have. And what a blessing. And we'll have a greater understanding of freedom too because of what Christ has done for us. And what a blessing that is. Are there any announcements today? Any announcements?
Can I sneak over here for a minute? All right.
Link it just a little.
Okay. Thank you, everybody, for your prayers this week. I had a heart cath procedure on Wednesday and didn't find any new or different blockage. So very thankful for that outcome. And I think today is Charlie Bonder's birthday, so if you happen to see Charlie out and about, you might wish him a happy birthday and belated to David Bontrager, I think celebrated yesterday.
What a blessing. Thank you. And let's just give God a big hand clap, can't we? Good news, birthdays.
May I say a word?
Yes, you may. That's what they told me I can always have one word, but I go over there.
I come before you this morning. I thank you for each and every card that I received this past week. It's been a real blessing to know all my brothers and sisters thought of me and sent me a card, and thank you for your messages that you have given me. I appreciate it very much. I know that the Lord has blessed me abundantly. After 95 years, I can't complain. I've seen a number of hard times, but you know, as we talked in class, the Lord has always been good, and it stood firm and true to him. He blessed me and brought me all the good things of life can offer. And I appreciate this church. I appreciate every one of you, our musicians, teachers, pastor, ushers, each one. You all mean a lot to me. I come here about 9 years ago, and you accepted me as one of you. And I thank you very much for it, because I consider you all my brothers and sisters in Christ. Amen. And it's like I told my family last night. I said, well, the Lord has been good to me. He's given me health in the last 15 years. I've had the best health of my life. I'm still able to get around and do good. And I bought myself a birthday present this past week. But anyhow, I talked to the kids. They all said, go for it, Dad. So anyhow, the Lord has blessed me. And I want you to know something that bears on my mind. When we live for God and we live for the Lord and we let our actions shine and let others know you love the Lord, that it's all for the glory of God. I have thought about that many times. But when you do something, you do it in the Lord's name and for the glory of God, He will bless you. Don't forget that. And I praise Him today for all that He's done. He has blessed me and given me good life. Thank you very much.
Thank you, David. What a blessing. What a testimony, 95 years and sharing that. And thank you again. Are there any other announcements? Yes.
Yes, sir.
I'm kind of new and old here. I grew up in Ellsworth, Kansas. My name is French Cowan. And I'm back here seeing my mother, Vicki Wacker. She's not doing very good, so I want to throw some prayers in for her. And I just want to let my brothers and sisters know that I love the Lord, and he's always been in my life, and I'm very blessed. So thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. And keep Vicki in her thoughts and prayers, please.
I just want us to continue to pray for Pastor and his wife, because they have a pretty big load on their shoulders. So we just need to continue to lift them up. And I want to also say that I think we're very blessed to have a congregation, a community that we do, that the Lord's there for all of us. So.
Thank you. Thank you.
Nancy and I have had several friends, neighbors, who have had medical issues. One of my best friends ever, Ron Davis, has had some surgery, and his family is undergoing some issues with health issues. And it just seemed like yesterday and the day before, we just had many, many phone calls about friends of ours. So I know that specifically you're probably not going to mention those people, but when you do pray for healing, keep in mind the Ron Davis family and several others that have had some issues. So congratulations to Dave. And I wouldn't have known French Cowan. I had him in school. He's a big guy. He was a little fellow then. And to have a fine job out in Arizona, he's done well. I appreciate, and the fact that he's a Christian man, what a blessing. Thank you.
Thank you. Are there any other announcements? Yeah. I thought I saw someone.
I just asked for prayers for my family. I found out that my first cousin was shot and killed pulling over to help somebody in South Wichita this morning. So if you could just keep them in your thoughts and prayers.
Okay. And you, all of you will be in our thoughts and prayers. Thank you for sharing that. It's a difficult time. Are there any others? Well, this is Independence Day and the freedom that we have, and what a blessing. But I also want to remind you, we weren't made to be independent of God. We've been made to be interdependent, to depend on God. And so let us center ourselves before the Lord, and then we'll have a time for greeting one another. Gracious God, we thank you and praise you. There's a lot of things that are going on in our world, in our country, in our state, in our city, in our town, in our neighborhood, and also in our families. Dear Lord, just minister to each and every heart. Draw us all closer to your love and grace. And I just thank you again for first loving us. In Jesus' precious name, amen and amen. So let's take a little time and welcome one another. Says a time for greeting one another, and we'll call you back also when you hear the leader say, "Lord be with you."
There was some good ones in there. I haven't said that on the
day yet.
You too. Was there some in there? She has one.
This is John.
Oh, really?
Good morning.
Good.
You may be seated while I have a call to worship.
Praise the Lord. Praise God in His sanctuary.
Praise God in His mighty arms.
Praise God for His mighty deeds.
Praise God for His exceeding grace.
Praise God with trumpet sound.
Praise God with lutes and harps.
Praise God with tambourine and dance.
Praise God with strings and pipes.
Praise God with sounding cymbals.
Praise God with loud clashing cymbals.
Let everything that breathes praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
And now we'll have pastoral prayer.
Gracious God, we thank you and praise you for this opportunity. That we would always be mindful to praise you, to worship you, to focus on you because you are so worthy. Dear Lord, you love us. You always have and you always will. Dear Lord, I want to lift up the joys and concerns that were expressed today. Dear Lord, I thank you for birthdays, for Charlie and Dave, and for the good news for Ken. Dear Lord, we lift up Vicky for continual healing, for the Davis family. Dear Lord, there are many that are hurting, that are broken. But we thank you that you're always there. You never leave, you never forsake, that we can always count on you. So minister to each and every heart. For those joys that were concerns that were not expressed, dear Lord, you know them and we just lift them up to you. I thank you again for your grace and mercy, for what you have done for us, for all the world. Dear Jesus, you died for all our sins, our past, present, and future. Minister to each and every heart. Draw us closer to you and to one another. And we thank you again for the country that we also live in, for the freedoms that we have. Dear Lord, what a blessing. Now, gracious God, we come before you today in a prayer that Jesus taught the disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thy kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Now at this time, if you're comfortable standing, would you please stand as we sing Praise the Lord with Sound of Trumpets, and we find that in the Faith We Sing, number 2020.
Thank you.
You may be seated. And at this time, we'll have special music. We'll have Kurt Krupp come and share with us.
Things were gone, I'd worked for all my life, and I had to start again with just my children and my wife. I thank my God above to be living here today, 'cause the flag still stands for freedom and they can't take that away. Where at least I know I'm free, and I won't forget the man who died, who gave that right to me. And I gladly stand up next to you and defend us here today, 'cause there ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the USA. The lakes of Minnesota to the hills of Tennessee, across the plains of Texas, from sea to shining sea, from Detroit down to Houston and New York to LA, for this pride in every American heart, and it's time we stand and say, proud to be an American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the man who died, who gave that right to me. I'll gladly stand up next to you and defend us here today, 'cause there ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the USA. An American, where at least I know I'm free, and I won't forget the man who died, who gave that right to me. And I gladly stand up next to you and defend her today, 'cause there ain't no doubt I love this land. But there's no
Thank you so much. At this time, we'll have the young disciples. Would the young disciples please come forward? Hello, ladies. Boy, you guys have beautiful dresses on, don't you? And that's Minnie Mouse. She's very patriotic. In red, white, and blue. Yes. And here, yeah, she has red, white. Both of them do. Wow. Isn't that awesome? So why would we wear red, white, and blue? Oh, and also in her hair. I can't pull that off very well. You can. Yes, you can, but I can't. Could you help me with that? Okay. Well, thank you. So why... I'm even wearing red, white, and blue. Why are we wearing red, white, and blue?
Because it's St. Patrick's Day.
Yes, 4th of July. Thank you. Don't worry, I'm not going to pinch you. All right. But yeah, it is 4th of July. That's our Independence Day. That's when we have We celebrate the freedom that we have. You're going to have some fireworks to go up the sky tonight. There was quite a few, you too. There was quite a few last night. Don't believe me, ask Barnabas. And that's her dog. And but yeah, so those are really big things, aren't they? And one thing is, when I think about that freedom that we can come to church and worship our God that loves us, and we can share it with others about God's love, right? And we also been made to have a relationship with God. Not independent of God, but interdependent, that we would depend on God. Who do you depend on? Who do you depend on? You depend on her? Well, that's good. It's always, because I'm going to be talking about friendship, all right, and how important it is. And we do need to depend on one another and help one another, right, and share with others that about God's love, okay? Can you guys do that? Oh, they are soft. They are soft. Okay. Well, I'm going to pray, and then the ushers will bring you something, okay? All right, let's pray. Well, dear Lord, thank you for loving us. We thank you for the freedom that we have as we celebrate the 4th of July. And thank you again for your love for us. And just minister to these children. In Jesus' precious name, amen and amen. All right. Now I'm going to sing Jesus Loves Me. Jesus loves me, this take their children, they can do that down to the nursery. Now we'll be singing What a Friend We Have in Jesus, and that's hymn number 526. this time, I'm going to have the ushers come forward, and we'll pray for the offering, and we'll receive the offering. We haven't done this for 15 months. We'll see how well we do. Not that you haven't given for 15 months. That isn't what I'm getting at. Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you for this opportunity. As we come before you, dear Lord, we ask that you would bless this offering. We thank you again for the opportunity to be in ministry with you. Dear Lord, we know that you're going to bless this offering. Dear Lord, we know that it's going to further your kingdom here in Ellsworth and throughout the world. The people would hear the good news of Jesus' life, death, and resurrection, that we serve a risen Lord that has defeated both sin and death, that is seated at the right hand of the Father Almighty, interceding for us. Dear Lord, we thank you. And we also ask that you bless each and every one here that can hear my voice. For those that are able to give financially, dear Lord, bless them. For those, dear Lord, that are able to serve, we thank you and that you would bless them. For those that are able to pray, we thank you. And for their presence, dear Lord, we thank you again. In Jesus' precious name, amen and amen.
Today is 1 Samuel chapter 20, verses 12 through 17, and in Pew Bibles it's on page 328. Jonathan said to David, "By the Lord of Israel, when I have sounded out my father about this time tomorrow, but if my father intends to do you harm, I'll start over. Jonathan said to David, "By the Lord, the God of Israel, when I have sounded out my father about this time tomorrow, or on the third day, if he is well disposed towards David, shall I not then send and disclose to you? But if my father intends to do you harm, the Lord do so to Jonathan. And more so, if I do not disclose it to you, and send you away so that you may go in safety, may the Lord be with you as he has been with my father. If I am still alive, show me the faithful love of the Lord. But if I die, never cut off your faithful love from my house. Even if the Lord were to cut off every one of the enemies of David from the face of the earth." Then Jonathan made a covenant with the house of David, saying, "May the Lord seek out the enemies of David." Jonathan made David swear again by his love for him, for he loved him as he loved his own life. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thank you, Karen. This time, let us go to the Lord in prayer. Thank you and praise you. As we look at your word today, dear Lord, direct us and guide us. I ask humbly that you would give me the words, that they'd be your words and not mine. That we have interpretation, application of your word, and because we know your word never returns void. I ask that you would hide me behind the cross of Jesus, and they'd see Jesus and not I. We thank you again. In Jesus' precious name, amen. Amen. And I'm going to ask the ushers to do me a favor. I left a bottle of water that I never did open. And I think I left it when I went to strike a match. There it is. I found out my voice was getting a little bit weak today. And so I might need a little water. And they said, "Great, now he's going to talk longer." All right. You know, when I look at this message today, I can see it even more prevalent because of COVID-19. The message is no more playing the Lone Ranger, because I at least find myself that I'm more task-oriented. I can set goals and go for it. You know, many times I don't always use people that I should, that are very gifted, and I try to do it on my own strength and own power, and how much better it would be if I would rely on my brothers and sisters. Now, women are much better at this than men, you know, and I know that. I've seen Betty keep relationships forever and ever, and it's such a blessing to see that. I remember... it's been, I guess, about 25 years ago. I was telling my mentor that, you know what, I think I'm ready to be a pastor now. I feel that calling. I think this is the right time. And he says, "Well, why is that, Dennis? How do you know that?" And I said, "Well, I don't have any friends, so I think I can be a pastor now." That's a true story, but I'll move on. You know, I'd have to admit, about setting goals, I mean, that's my excuse. You could have said that about me. Once I set a goal and my passion is to go for it, to reach it. Now, there's nothing wrong with setting goals.
And there's nothing wrong about moving ahead to reach them, but often that becomes a convenient excuse or camouflage, if you would, for not building relationships along the way. Building those relationships are so important. I've even heard men here in this past 6 months say how they would like to have a relationship with others and that would help hold them accountable and how they could grow together and how their families could grow. And, you know, I pray that. I have to admit, two of my favorite TV programs that I used to watch maybe helped me learn how to, because they weren't much on building relationships. There were two of them when I was a child. One of them was The Lone Ranger. I know it was a rerun, but I loved watching that. His face was always hidden and with a mask. And my most favorite was Batman, and his face was hidden. And he wasn't much on relationships with just Robin and Alfred, and that was about it. And the only time the mask was off The Lone Ranger is when his back was turned to you. Or when he was in disguise. You remember when he was in disguise a few times? Like he was an old prospector or something like that? But he never revealed his true identity. The Lone Ranger and Tonto would ride into town and get rid of the bad guys. Then as they rode off to the distance, and he would say, "Hi-ho, Silver," in the way, and someone would always ask, "Who was that masked man? Do you guys remember any of this?" Okay, four of us. And who was that masked man? And we all knew he was the Lone Ranger. He was the Lone Ranger. You know, and that describes the way a lot of us live today. It's very easy for us to put on a mask and play a role, maybe leaving people to wonder, who is that masked person? Because a lot of us hide out when it comes to authentic relationships. We hide out when it comes to authentic relationships. So I want to talk about relationships today. Because relationships is a top priority. It's a top priority in God's program. Do you remember what God said about Adam before he created Eve? He said, "It's not good for man to be alone," in Genesis chapter 2, verse 18. God's first comment on the state of human beings was that Adam needed a helper. Adam needed someone to have a relationship with. You see, he had that vertical relationship with God. We know God walked with him in the coolness of the day, but he needed that horizontal relationship. And not only this, but in Philippians chapter 2, verse 4, each of you should look not only to your own interests, but also the interest of others. Not only do you need a good relationship for yourself, but you need to provide that for others too. Others are needing a relationship. Others are needing someone they can count on, that they can trust, that they know that they can come to, that they know that someone would pray for them, that they wouldn't just tell everyone, but they would care for them and tenderly and lift them up to God. We can see how important relationships are in God's program by looking at the way he has constructed the church. He calls it the body. The body of Christ. A body is not just a bunch of parts that are more than acquaintance. I can tell you this much. If you would drop a brick on your bare foot, on your toe, not only would your toe know, but your whole body would know. Actually, I did this in this church on Good Friday, but it wasn't a brick, but I had Ted sitting behind me, and I was up there where you couldn't see me, and I had two pieces of wood, and I was hitting on it so it would sound like someone was hammering Jesus on the cross. And Ted saw it so well. I came down and I hit my thumbnail, And I thought Ted was going to lose it because all I said was wrong nail. But I felt it. Ted really enjoyed it. And for the next couple of months, he always liked looking at that nice purple color on my thumbnail. But we are connected. We are connected. And your head and your neck aren't just neighbors. I've learned that here just this other day. I went and got my eyes on Thursday. Went to the eye doctor and they dilated them. And so my pupils are this big. And it was raining a little bit. And I was in the right-hand lane needing to go on the left-hand lane so I could come back to Ellsworth. And I saw a car earlier, and I was driving my other car, not the one that lets me know that someone's coming, all right? And I'm driving our Camry, and I didn't think I saw anyone, and I didn't because it was in a blind spot. So I'm turning in, and all of a sudden, like that, jerk, and poor Betty, good thing she was buckled up, or she would have hit the glass, I know. And, you know, for a couple of days, my neck started hurting, and like I said, all of us are connected. We're all intricately related. When it comes to parts of our bodies, we don't want any member packing up or taking off or leaving us. And that's the way it is with the body of Christ. Each one is significant. Each one is important. God has gifted you with different gifts and different graces. And when you're not here, the body doesn't function as well as it should, or when you're not, but you've said that you would do, and it is so important. It is so vital. And it's the same in the body of Christ. In 1 Corinthians chapter 12, 12 through 27, Paul was using the analogy of a body to let us know that every member of the body of Christ is needed. And each one is needed. No member can say to another member, I don't need you. Because every part of the body is significant. Every part of the body is important. For instance, in Hebrews 10:25, tells us not to neglect meeting together as the church. But in verse 24, we find that the context for this exhortation is our need to spur one another on towards love and good deeds, that we would spur one another, help one another in love and in good deeds, so we don't just come to church just to show up and be counted. We come because we are related. As David so well said after 9 years, you are my brothers and sisters in Christ. You know, and I look back and I see my brothers and sisters from Mosaic, and you guys have been here about the last month, and it's such a blessing to have you back in our church family. It is such a blessing. It's a blessing to have all of you here. What a blessing that is. Because I believe everyone should intentionally reach out and develop a meaningful relationship with others. Maybe different ages, maybe different races, whatever. But to develop an important relationship with one another. When I look at that, I think of Jesus and his relationships. An important investment. In John 15:14, on the night that Jesus was betrayed, he's talking to the disciples. He looked at the disciples and said, "You are my friends." Remember that he had Judas in that bunch. One of the 12 was going to turn him in, was going to betray him. And Jesus knew it. Jesus was God in the flesh, but he still invested in all of them. Because he knew 11 of them would be committed, they would commit their lives to tell people of the good news throughout the world. He wanted them all to know that he loved them. And he wanted them to love others. and then Paul and his relationships. An essential encouragement, Paul wrote a letter to Timothy in 2 Timothy. May the Lord show mercy to the house of Onesiphorus, because he often refreshed me, in 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 16. Then Paul urged Timothy himself to get here before winter, in 2 Timothy 4:21. These were the last of his days. And Paul was saying, I'm lonely in this prison cell. It's cold, and I need your friendship. I need you. It's important. Please come. Please come. Relationships are so critical and so very important. Our need for relationships, they're necessary, not just nice. They are necessary. Good relationships are not just nice. They're biblically necessary. Paul tells us in Galatians chapter 6, verses 1 and 2, brothers, if someone is caught in sin, you who are spiritual should restore them gently, carrying each other's burdens, and in this way you will fulfill the law of Christ. We can't restore one another unless we are close enough to know them, to know that they are hurting, or unless they feel comfortable enough with us to say, I need help. I need help. Some biblical examples. In the Old Testament, Israel was battling with the Amalekites. Moses told Joshua to choose some of your men and go out and fight them, the Amalekites. And tomorrow I will stand on top of the hill and I will raise my staff of God in my hands. And when he raised his hands up, the Israelites were winning. He also had Aaron and Hur with him. And when he started to weaken and his arms came down, the enemy was winning. But when his arms were up, the Israelites were winning. So his friends had him sit on a rock and they supported his arms to keep them up, and they won the war. You know, a generation is at stake. The generation coming behind us is at stake. Supporting each other is not just for us. If we don't hold each other's hands up, our boys and girls will become casualties in the battle. There are some Amalekites out there in the world who want to pervert our children, to rob them of their purity, to rob them of their faith in Christ. Unless we hold each other up, that we'd hold our hands up, the Amalekites are going to prevail, that they will prevail. I'm going to talk about three kinds of friendships that you cannot live without. Each person needs three kinds of friendships. A cord of three broken from Ecclesiastes chapter 4, verse 12. It's hard to break three ropes wound together. Paul would be the first. He was older. He was more mature believer. A father figure. Someone who had been where we're trying to go. A Paul to her Timothy. And there are many of you are Pauls. And you don't have to be men. But there are many of you that are Paul and have gone there before. And have that spiritual maturity that you can help a Timothy. That you can help someone that hasn't gone where you have gone. And then there's a Barnabas. And I'm not talking about my dachshund, because his name is Barnabas. I don't know if you knew that. But this is the second kind of friend we need, is a soul brother or sister. Someone that loves you but is not all that impressed with you. In other words, someone that is on your level. a friend who can relate to you where you are because he or she has gone through that same stuff. It's accountability partner, where two can work things together. You know, and I've had this myself for a lot, probably in the last 20 years. And it's so helpful. I used to get up at and be at Cracker Barrel at 6 o'clock every Friday morning, and I'd have 8 or 9 that was that Barnabas that we could share and hold each other accountable, and it was so important. Or the third is a Timothy, along with a father and a brother, or a mother and a sister, you also need a child. Timothy to your Paul, to provide a model that younger men and boys and girls and ladies can look up to. A mentor, a tutor, or a coach. A biblical example of real friendship. And I want to look at David and Jonathan. What was read earlier by Karen. Was Jonathan saying, you know, I can't believe my father would do this to you, but if he would, you know what? I'm going to let you know. He knew that David was called by God to be the next king. Now, if we would look at it on the human level, on a worldly level, we would know that Jonathan would be the next king. But he knew that David was. And he knew David, with the covenant they made, if anything happened to him, David would take care of his family. And that's exactly what he did. David and Jonathan, they were two manly men. We can look at 1 Samuel in chapter 4, verses 1 through 15, where Jonathan went out with a young teenager, and he took on 20 Philistines, but he did it in the power of the Lord. We also know that David did the same thing in 1 Samuel 17 when he took on Goliath. And he didn't do it with the power of the sword or a javelin, but he did it in the power of the Lord. When I look at how David, when they asked him, when Saul asked him, because they were brother and kindred spirits, David and Jonathan, he said, "Whose son are you, young man?" Saul asked him. David said, "I am the son of your servant, Jesse of Bethlehem." And after David had finished talking with Saul, Jonathan became one in spirit with David, and he loved him as himself. Also in verses 3 and 4 of chapter 18, "And Jonathan made a covenant with David because he loved him as himself. Jonathan took off his robe he was wearing, gave it to David along with a tunic, and even the sword and his bow and his belt." See, he was giving him all the possessions of the next king, but because of his love for him. He wasn't saying, "I'm not going to surrender," but he said, "Yes, take it, David. I love you and I care for you, and I know you love me as well." Well, risk and rewards of a covenantal friendship. When we look at 1 Samuel chapter 20, verses 31 through 33a. "As long as the son of Jesse lives on the earth, neither you nor your kingdom will be established. Now send someone to bring him to me, for he must die." This is Saul talking. Why should he be put to death? "What has he done?" Jonathan asked his father. In 1 Samuel 20, 34, "Jonathan got up from the table in fierce anger, and on the second day of the feast, he did not eat because he was grieved at his father's shameful treatment of David." making friendship is a reality. John Wesley and William Wilberforce. John Wesley was spurring William Wilberforce on because he was going to the Parliament to overthrow slavery. And it was 30 years even after he received this letter from John Wesley to encourage him. When I look at making friendship, here's some of the things that one can do. Talk to your friend. Ask them, what scripture they read today? How are you praying today? Have you had any flirtations or lustful attitudes, tempting thoughts, or expose yourself to any illicit materials that would not glorify God? These are things that John Wesley would ask. Have you been completely above reproach in your financial dealings? Have you spent quality relationship time with your family and friends? Have you done your 100% best on your job? Have you told any half-truths or outright lies, putting yourself in a better light to those around you? Have you shared the gospel with a non-believer? Have you taken care of your body through your daily physical exercise and proper eating and sleeping habits? Boy, I'm not even 2 out of 3 on that one. Have you allowed any person or circumstances to rob you of your joy? Have you allowed anyone, person or circumstances, to rob you of your joy? Have you lied to me on any of these previous questions? You know, these were things that they asked. That's what we should ask or brothers and sisters, those that are that Barnabas, or maybe those that are Timothy, or maybe we're the Timothy and we ask the Paul. You see, we've been made for relationships. Even the Lone Ranger had Tonto. We're not to do it on our own. Over 50 times in the New Testament, it talks about the one another. Love one another. Care for one another. Pray for one another. Lift one another up. You see, this was what God desired. This was God's plan. This is our DNA, that we would be in community together. That we would be with one another and help one another. Here in a very short time, we'll have communion. And it's the Lord's table. And when I receive communion, I'm also reminded that others are receiving. Others are receiving communion and remembering that they are loved, that they are forgiven, and the Lord is with us. Let us pray. Gracious God, I just thank you and praise you. Just minister to each and every heart. We thank you again for your love and grace. In Jesus' precious name, amen. Would the communion stewards please come forward? And this is an open table, and it's for all that you would receive. Just as God's grace is for all. So when you come forward, I'll have you shape your hand like a cross. And then I'll place the bread in your hand. And they would also give the cup on each side. And then after you're through receiving communion and taking, you can put the cup in the trash cans. And then after it's over, we will all receive communion. on that night that Jesus was betrayed, he took the bread, he blessed it, and he broke it. He said, this is my body. Take, eat, and do this in remembrance of me. And after the supper, he took the cup and blessed it. He said, this is a new covenant. My blood shed for the forgiveness of your sins. Take, drink, and do this in remembrance of me. Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you for this time. Dear Lord, we ask that you would bless these elements, these sacraments, to draw us closer to you, to reflect on your love, on your forgiveness, what you have done in our life, what you're doing, and what you will do. And knowing that you're always with us, we thank you and praise you. In Jesus' precious name, amen. I'll have the ushers have you come forward so you may receive. Yeah, Ken's got his. Yeah, he got it. The body and blood of Christ given for you, Alan. Nancy, the body and blood of Christ given for you. Body and blood of Christ given for you, John. Jesus loves you. There you go, buddy. Jesus loves you, hon. Okay. Body and blood of Christ given for you. 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 David, the body and blood of Christ given for you. Rose, the body and blood of Christ given for you. Body and blood of Christ given for you. Jerry, the body and blood of Christ given for you. Body and blood of Christ given for you. Given for you.
one's communion. No one. No one. Yeah, okay. All right, thank you. All right, I guess we're done. Have all received communion that wants to? Dear Lord, we thank you and praise you for this time. Continually to minister to our hearts. Draw us closer to you and to one another. We thank you again. In Jesus' precious name, amen. Thank you so much. And if you're comfortable standing, would you please stand as we sing our last hymn, We Are the Church, number 558. God, we thank you and praise you.
how significant and how important relationships are. Our relationship with you and with others. And dear Lord, that we would share with others that may not know you the love that you have for them. And dear Lord, what a blessing that is. So I send them out in your power. Power of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. In Jesus' precious name, amen and amen. God bless you all.